Hachette Audio presents Still All Right, a memoir, written and read by me, Kenny Loggins. Introduction. This story doesn't start with a disappearing truck, but it certainly fucking feels like it does. In 1989, two things happened at once that would deeply impact my career. The first was that I began recording what would become my Leap of Faith album. The second was that Don Eider became president of Columbia Records. I'd been with Columbia since the very beginning, through 8 Loggins and Messina albums and 7 solo ones. I'd sold millions of records and reached the top of the charts, just not that much of late. It had been 3 years since Danger Zone and 5 years since Footloose. Given that I hadn't had a top 10 album since 1978, company execs were beginning to wonder if I still had it. Among Einar's first orders of business was to figure out the label's obligations. And when he got around to reviewing my contract, he saw that I was already $500,000 into studio costs and counting for Leap of Faith, and not a person on his staff had actually heard the music. From where I sat, though, that half mil was money well spent. So much music was pouring through me that Leap of Faith had all but written itself, every word and note falling perfectly into place. Melodic ideas scored my dreams so frequently that I kept a tape recorder next to the bed. For the first time in my life, I could imagine complete songs as if they were playing on my stereo. The arc of the album was following the arc of my life, and I was writing it all as it unfolded before me. I innately understood everything I wanted the music to be. Columbia had recently been acquired by Sony, and the new boss was busy slashing the slumping label's artist roster, ultimately cutting loose a third of the acts. I'd already spent a ton of their money on my new record, and it wasn't even finished yet. I grew nervous. Would I be the next to go? The West Coast head of A&R for Columbia, a guy named Ron Oberman, certainly thought so. He lobbied Einar to drop me from the label as part of the overall house cleaning efforts. Luckily for me, my old friend Bobby Columbi, the founding drummer of Blood, Sweat, and Tears, had recently become the senior VP for creative development, not just for Columbia Records, but for all of Sony Music. When Einar called Bobby to get his take on who he might cut from the label, Bobby convinced him I should stay by promising to personally shepherd my new project. Apparently, Columbi and Oberman had quite the confrontation over it. The urban legend is that Bobby held Ron out the second-story window until he reassessed his position. I doubt anything like that actually happened. But Bobby's a native New Yorker, and I wouldn't have put it past him. At the very least, it illustrates the kind of passionate support he gave me. Before too long, I received word that Don wanted to hear what I'd recorded. He set a meeting for a month out. Trouble was, Leap of Faith was still in bits and pieces at that point. I didn't even have any rough mixes ready to show him, let alone all the overdubs I'd planned. None of the songs even sounded like a record yet. I had a lot of work ahead of me to make it right, and it was increasingly clear that Donnie's opinion would be the deciding factor when it came to my future with Columbia. Yeah, it was kind of stressful. As it happened, Einar's message arrived just as I was packing up my operation for a move from L.A. to Santa Barbara. By that point, the basic tracks were in place, and I wanted to do the overdubs, my vocals, a ton of percussion, lots of secondary instrumentation closer to home. Into the truck went our amps, guitars, microphones, stands, speakers, along with 2 Mitsubishi 32-track digital recorders and the big 18-inch reels containing the master tapes. I had 30 days to get everything ready for my big meeting, and I needed every minute of them. Then it all went sideways. It's only a 90-minute drive from L.A. to Santa Barbara, an easy hop. But after an all-nighter at the studio, the guitar tech driving the van decided to stop at home for a shower and a quick nap. And that's when the truck was stolen. It was just fucking gone. Bobby called me at home with the news. I couldn't have cared less about the instruments or the recorders. Those were replaceable. My master tapes, though, were priceless. The sum of 12 months of steady toil put into the album. I still had the slave reels, though that was small consolation. In the days before unlimited digital tracking, slaves were mixed down from master recordings to leave as much space as possible for overdubs, which could then be transferred back to the original high-quality master. It's unfortunate terminology, but it was the industry standard back then. The recording quality on the tapes in my possession was unacceptable for an official release, let alone a career-saving preview for Columbia's new boss. They were good enough for me to take cues from, but not much else. This is going to sound weird, but when I heard my tapes were missing, I didn't panic. Not even a little. There's no logical explanation for it, but despite every upsetting detail, I knew instinctively that things would turn out okay. Really, I had only one decision to make. I could return to LA and re-record the basic tracks in a hurry, or I could proceed as if nothing had happened and continue to overdub on my slaves according to the original plan. If the masters failed to emerge, the quality would be far too low for Einar to approve. Add to that the expense of re-recording everything, and my time with Columbia would almost certainly be over. Leap of faith would probably never see daylight. So I took a literal leap of faith. I knew in my bones that those tapes would return. Not hoped, I knew. And not eventually, but in time for my meeting with Einar. This was the record I'd been waiting all my life to make, coming to me in waves of inspiration like nothing I'd ever experienced before. How could all this music be flowing through me, only to end up lost and abandoned? The decision was instantaneous for me. Obvious, almost as soon as Bobby had told me what had happened. In fact, I laid out my plan during that very same phone call. Bobby was too despondent to even offer a pretense of reassurance. "I'm so sorry, dude," he said. "This is a disaster, really. What are you going to do?" Somehow, I found myself talking him off the ledge. "It's going to be okay, Bobby," I said. He probably thought I'd lost my mind. "So you're saying you're going to re-record the masters?" he asked. I smiled at what should have been a devastating question. "No," I said. "I'm going to keep on going as if nothing's happened. Then I'll mix it all together when the truck shows up." Bobby took a long breath. "Can I have some of what you're taking?" he whispered. I had no idea how any of this would happen, of course, only that it was a certainty. I kept working away on those slaves, adding a one-of-a-kind performance by synth wizard John Barnes, some vocal harmonies by Mavis Staples, and an amazing David Lindley slide guitar solo while I waited for the good news. A week went by, then two. Still no word. I kept working. 3 weeks. Now we're counting days. 5 days before the biggest meeting of my career, it happened. My manager, Shep Gordon, called to tell me the truck had been located just a few blocks from where it was stolen. "There were about a dozen tickets on the windshield," he said. Obviously, we were the recipients of some pretty expert sleuthing by our local police department. I'm sure he was joking about that last part. I was thrilled by the news, right up until Shep told me the cargo box had been cleaned out. Every instrument was gone. Those Mitsubishi recorders were probably already being parted out in Mexico. Oh, shit. What about the master tapes? I stopped breathing, hoping there was more. There was. The only items left behind, Bobby said, locked up safe in the cab, were my tapes. All 4 master reels. The more I thought about it, the more I wondered if somebody connected with the studio, maybe a recording engineer, had been in on the heist. Those instruments were valuable, but the tapes weren't worth much to anybody but me. Whoever did it clearly knew enough about what was going on to secure them up front. So whoever you are, thanks for that, I guess. Within 12 hours, my engineer and co-producer, Terry Nelson, was piecing together songs, dubbing new tracks we'd recently recorded onto the master reels. We worked around the clock for 4 days straight. Our final task involved cutting a special version for my meeting with Einar, a digital audio tape with all the instrumentation, but none of my lead vocals. Bobby had insisted I perform those live. "It'll be like a personal concert," he said. "You'll blow them away." I'd never heard of anyone doing something like that. It was unorthodox and risky. But hell, so was my album. I agreed. Yeah, the meeting was that important. On barely any sleep, we wrapped things up with only hours to spare. The next morning, I drove to the Beverly Wilshire Hotel, where Einar had a cabana in the gardens out back. First, though, I had to make a stop. Shep was auctioning off a wall from his office for charity. It had been autographed by some of the world's most prominent performers, and he wanted me to add my name before it was removed from the premises. I ended up signing underneath Raquel Welch and Cher, and wrote one thing more. something Geronimo once said to his warriors before sending them into battle. Quote, "It is a good day to die." If you were going to war, the theory went, fight as if you are already dead, and you'd have nothing to lose. Given my upcoming meeting, it seemed appropriate. From there, I headed to the Beverly Wilshire, where I found Einar in his cottage. Columbia was already there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.